to seven springs of living water. Let's all stand together when we find that. 3, 2, 7 on that first together.
I thirsted in the barren land of sin and shame, and nothing satisfying there I found. But to the blessed cross of Christ one day I came, where springs of living water did abound. Drinking at the springs of living water, happy now am I, my soul they satisfy. Drinking at the springs of living water, oh, wonderful and bountiful supply. How sweet the living waters from the hills of God. It makes me glad and happy all the way. Now glory, grace, and blessing mark the path I've trod. I'm shouting hallelujah every day. Drinking at the springs of living water, happy now am I, my soul they satisfy. Drinking at the springs of living water, oh, wonderful and bountiful supply. Oh, sinner, won't you come today to Calvary? A fountain there is flowing deep and wide. The Savior now invites you to the water free, where thirsting spirits can be satisfied. Drinking at the springs of living water, happy now am I, my soul they satisfy. Drinking at the springs of living water, oh, wonderful and bountiful supply.
Amen. Very good. The junior choir, I think, is singing this morning, or this evening. They're not out there? All right. Well, maybe they'll sing after another song. Let's open tonight with... They're coming? All right. Very good. We'll let them come on up. Fantastic. Quite the dapper group. Very good. We'll let them get into place, then we'll open our service and prayer and hear from the Glow Club. All right. Very good. All right. Well, let's open with a word of prayer, and then we'll hear from the Glow Club. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for just a great evening. We're looking forward to what you have for us tonight. Lord, I pray that you would just open our hearts to receive your word tonight. Pray that this service would just go according to your plan. Lord, I'm just so grateful that we have a place here where we can worship you and praise you and honor you and hear from your word. God, I pray that you would just be magnified in the service tonight. In Jesus' precious and holy name we do pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Child of love, in a last of home, only ever your love, child to.
can. Very good. Great job. Well, if you haven't figured it out yet, Pastor is not here. He is home ill. It caught him. So, and it took him good. You know it's good if he's not here. Or it's bad, one way or the other, however you look at it. But we'll continue on without him, right? I'm sure he's watching on live stream. Let's go to 441. 441. I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me. Sunlight in the soul. On that first together. I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me. And with the sunlight of his love bid all my darkness flee. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. Ladies, would you sing that second all together? Though clouds guys, go ahead and join. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. All right, guys, let's do that third. While walking in the light of God, I sweet communion find. I press with holy vigor on and leave this world behind. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. On that last together, soon I shall see him as he is, the light that came to me. Behold the brightness of his face throughout eternity. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love.
Tonight, some letters from the Knickerbocker family missionaries to Nepal. New Year's greetings from Nepal. We are excited about the opportunities in ministry this year in Nepal as well as in America. Following the school year, we plan to go on furlough in the States. We will be available to visit your church between June and December. We plan to be headed up the East Coast in August, up north in September, then out to Texas in October. We will then head back home to Florida. Not being the sensational type, I have said very little about the laws and challenges legally we deal with as we minister here. Under Article 26.3 of Nepal's new constitution, introduced in September of 2005, as the nation transitioned from a Hindu monarchy to a secular democratic republic, it is punishable by law to convert somebody from one religion to another or act in a way that may jeopardize another's religion. Though we do give out tracts with discretion, we have been reminded this past year that the government has intensified its scrutiny on Christians. Back in July, 8 Christians working with an NGO during an earthquake relief project were put in jail for giving children Christian literature. Even though they had the school's official permission, police stopped them as they were leaving the village and found a Bible, using that as evidence against them. We have friends who have had police monitoring some of their services under the guise of providing protection. Though we have been blessed to not have been caught as of yet, it caused me to consider how we can still sow the incorruptible seed in a voluminous way, yet under the radar. With the aforementioned considerations, I have also had the following observations. Many people will ask you for your business card. We have found that animal balloons to be very popular. Many people, even in the village, have smartphones and accessibility to the internet. Most people speak Nepali, English, and/or Tibetan. And many are interested in Christianity but are afraid of rejection from their family and friends. With all these factors brewing, I thought, why can't we have an evangelistic website to aid in teaching the truth to those who really want the answers to life? We can make short videos and offer helpful literature. Hence, I would like to introduce the brand new gospel tool, pilgrimoftruth.com. We also have a Nepali domain name, which he gives, which is linked to the same address. Here you can see and hear the greatest story on earth with balloons. We have made business cards which advertise this, also a gospel track about the earthquake, a 10-lesson Bible study about understanding Bible Christianity, and a study in the Gospel of John are available. This is literally years of work collected in one accessible place. I've worked a lot since November on the website, and we have much more to do to improve it. I would love your feedback and ideas. We have also made pens and coffee mugs as promotional items to give away. Please be in prayer for this project as it can potentially reach people anywhere in the world. My desire is to add the Tibetan and Hindi languages, enabling us to cover virtually everyone in Nepal. Of course, tools are only as good as the workers using them. We realize our greatest work here is equipping God's people to be effective here through the local church. The Crown Bible College has resumed for the spring semester, with Jamie teaching English and Luke teaching Bible doctrine and parables. Thank you for your prayers and special gifts for Christmas. For God's glory, the Knickerbockers.
Amen. Knickerbockers are doing some great work there in Nepal. If you would, take your prayer guide. Anybody need a prayer guide? Anybody not get one? Bill, looks like Heather Joy needs one. Anybody else need a prayer guide? You put your hand up. Not sure I'll get one to you. Very good. Well, let's start on the back. We have the coming events, and continue to pray for RU Inside. They're both at CRC and at London. We'll be at CRC tomorrow evening, and then London Saturday morning, and then hear the RU Recovery Program on Friday evening as well. Continue praying for that ministry if you would. Coming up, February 5th, I Love My Bible Sunday. Don't forget the coin and the quarter and dollar folders. You can put them in the box up here when you get them filled. Or we will also be taking out an offering that morning for the Bibles there going to India. Looking forward to hearing great reports when Brother Yoder gets over there to give those Bibles. That's pretty exciting stuff. And then on February 12th, you're going to be planning It's I Love My Family Sunday. And as we have in the last couple years, be ready to do a family portrait that day. We'll have a couple stations set up for you, and you can get your family portrait done, and we can email it to you following that, all right? And then I think that's about it there. Saturday, we do have our soul winning and bus visitation, 10 a.m. And then if you look on the inside, under the parade reports, CRC was great last week. They had 15 and 7 new guys, and 7 were saved. So it was a good good day. And then 11 there at London, doing a great job there as well. Be continuing to pray for those on the health list. Susan Dunmore had surgery Monday, and pray she'll be recovering from that. Continue praying for Paula Ross. My understanding is that she did much better than anticipated through the surgery, and so we do praise the Lord for that. You can put Pastor down there on the health list. He caught this bug and caught it pretty heavy. So pray that he'll get back to us soon, which I'm sure he will. And all of those other items here, Adam Walters there. Good to see Adam tonight. Amen. Good to have you this evening. And Pray for there's an authority. We updated that list, so we have the current president, vice president, and majority leader and minority leader there. Continue to pray for those in authority, and that they'll just make wise choices. And what makes a good leader, I believe, is surrounding yourself with good people. And so just really pray for our president that he continues to surround himself with those right people, and so that there can be some great decisions made there at the federal level. And then don't forget the military cancer salvation list. Sometimes that salvation list is the one that gets passed by all too many times, but the souls of men and women are a big deal. That's what we're all about. Continue praying for the missionaries, well, highlighted by the Knickerbocker families, and then the unreached people groups. It's another list that sometimes we just see it, and sometimes it's just daunting. There's 10 people groups every week that are in there. We've had this a couple years now, I believe. We're over 1,000, and we're if you see that, we're in China. That's in the seas, and it goes in alphabetical order. If that gives you an idea as to how many unreached people groups there are, it's a daunting, daunting task. So continue to pray for those. All right. Like Brother Wallace, if you would, come and pray for these things. And as he prays audibly, if you'll pray with him silently. And Brother Wallace.
Let us pray. Father, we want to thank you for being such a great God. Lord, we thank you also for your grace. If it were not for your grace, none of us would be here. We would not have eternal salvation. We would not have a seat already in heaven. We would not have already a home in heaven. We're seated in heavenly places because of your grace. It's because of your grace that I come tonight to enter your throne room. Lord, with being humble and yet being bold enough to know that you hear and answer our prayers. And Lord, you've promised so many promises in your word. How could we ever back up from that and not trust it? You're an all-knowing, all-powerful, all-living God. So Father, as we bring these requests to you, there's a lot of things that we miss because most of the time, we don't know exactly what to pray for. We pray in general terms, and we know that you know every situation. Lord, as I look over these prayer lists on a weekly basis, I see that, Lord, I was having a conversation with someone just this week about how just on our prayer list, just the 70 missionaries that we have and the ones that we pray for and the thousands of people that must just involve those 70 that have children and grandchildren and uncles and aunts. And Lord, we just pray that your will would be done in everyone's life. Lord, that you would give them the wherewithal to do the job that you commanded them to do, to take the world, the word into all the world. And Father, we know that, Lord, as Brother Bob was saying, sometimes we miss the salvation list, but we know that that's what your whole purpose was for. And Father, we pray for those people on the salvation list, that, Lord, you will send somebody into their life. Some of them have been on there for years. And Lord, we would like to see some reports back that people come to our church and darken the door that we've had on there for years and that have gotten saved, and we know not where, but Lord, we'd like to hear some good news like that, if it be your will. Father, I do pray for the unreached people groups, and Lord, as Brother Yoder and Brother Moreland and other men of God go over there and try to spread your gospel, your word. I pray, Lord, that this money that we're taking up for the Bibles, and as they take the Bibles over, that, Lord, that you would give those people a deeper hunger than what we've ever heard of before, than what we've ever seen before, that it would be as if they would think they were dying if they didn't have your word. Lord, I just pray that your power will be upon them, that the Holy Spirit will already be preparing hearts, that, Lord, will fall down and bow to you and call out to you and by faith trust in you. And Father, as we pray for these things, we pray for the ministries of this church. We pray for the RU ministry here on Friday nights and the prison ministries at CRC in London. And Lord, as we give these numbers every week about how many stand up for salvation, Lord, we just trust that their hearts were true, that they really meant it when they stood up and called out to you. And Lord, we would just ask that you would do a mighty work in them, that we would someday see them come out of there and that more of them would walk the walk, not only talk the talk, but walk the walk. And Lord, we would see good testimonies from their lives. And Lord, that the desire in their heart that you would put in their heart, that you would do greater works in them than we've ever seen before. Father, I do pray for our church. Lord, I lift our church up to you. We're just people who need you. And Lord, none of us are perfect, but we need your strength. We need your wisdom. We need your knowledge. And Lord, without that, we wouldn't be able to walk the walk. And Lord, I just pray that you would be with us every day. Be with our pastor as he is home recovering. I pray that you be with Ronnie and his wife and Mrs. Ross. And Lord, just help her to continue to recover. Lord, I can't imagine being in the hospital for 6 or 7 months and things just, the devil just trying to beat you down and beat you down. And Lord, give her the strength she needs to continue to trust in you and to draw strength from you. Lord, there has to be a little fear there because of human nature, but yet, Lord, help her to shine for you even in the darkest of time. And Father, help her husband, encourage him, encourage her dad. Lord, you are, and show him that you are the God of all gods. Yeah. And Father, as we come and open up your word, Lord, I pray that our hearts will be tender to your word. I pray that it'll be teachable. And Lord, that we'll walk out of here tonight at least having a little nugget to encourage us to continue to walk in your word. And Lord, we just ask that all things would be done to glorify your name. It's in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, let's turn over to 75, if you would. Number 75 in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. 75, when you find that, would you stand with me, please? There's a land that is fairer than day. On that first, let's sing it all together. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet. By and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious song of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more. Not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by,
time we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together.
In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Let's sing that last together. To our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise on that last.
To our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love and the blessings that hallow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Amen. You may be seated. Very good. Sisters, come. Wednesday evening offering. Brother Bill McKeon, would you? The offering, please.
Let's pray.
Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity we have to come and worship you. Lord, help it to be a refreshing time, Lord, and bless this offering. Bless both the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
a good song. I shall know him by the print of the nails in his hand. That's great. Thank you, Lisa. Well, we have the opportunity to hear from Brother Yoder tonight. I'm grateful for him being able to stand in the gap. I remember the last time that I remember, anyway, that he preached for us. And, man, it was good. Was it Five Crowns, I believe? And I put those notes in my Bible. I might use those someday. But that was good. Looking forward to you, Brother Yoder. Give us what God's given you, all right?
Well, it's a tremendous privilege to be here tonight. Keep your prayers and mine on the pastor. We sure do miss him when he's not here. Now, I'm not going to be using the thing that's in the bulletin, so you can save that for another week. I would like for you to turn in your Bible to John chapter 4. And I am very excited about going to India. The time is coming upon me very soon. I'm excited about the Bible's offering that we're going to be taking. It's almost like a dream come true, being able to take Bibles to a nation on the other side of the world. I would ask that you would continue to pray for my voice. Right now it's really good, and the history of my voice is not too good. And they have me scheduled to preach over there four times a day for 2.5 hours a day the last week I'm there. So pray about that. I believe that the Lord can help me, but I just need God's prayer concerning my voice. Now, it'll be good and strong tonight, so I'll keep you awake. That way you'll be able to sleep tonight. But John chapter 4, let's all stand. We're going to read one verse. We're going to read verse 29. John chapter 4. Verse 29, the Bible says, "Come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ?" Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, I pray that you would be close to us tonight. I pray that Jesus would be real to us. I pray that we'd get a new look at the Son of Man. And I pray, Lord, that all the honor and glory would be given to him. We'd ask especially that you'd be with our pastor. Lord, I pray that you'd strengthen his body and help him tonight. We'd ask all these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, we just went through the Christmas season and celebrated Christmas Day and everything that comes with it. I mean, there were the trees and the tinsel and the lights and the bulbs and the carols and the Feliz Navidad and the ribbons and the cards and the bows and the reindeer and the boxes and the train sets and the presents and the shopping and the food and more food and more food. Amen. And there was cookies and candy and toys and football. Did I mention football? Jingle bells and Santa Claus and family time and Holly and snowmen and the Grinch and Cindy Lou Who, Ebenezer Scrooge and Tiny Tim, Charlie Brown and Schroeder jamming on the piano, and Wonderful Life and Miracle on 34th Street, Christmas stars, shepherds, and the three wise guys. But in all of this, where was Christ? The Bible says, "Come see a man." Did we see Christ at Christmas time? You know, the most important thing is not the history of Jesus Christ. The most important thing is your relationship with Jesus Christ. I heard a message years ago, knowing right, doing right, and being right. The most important thing is being right with God. Of course, you can't be right with God if you don't know what right is, and you can't be right with God if you're not doing right. But our relationship with Jesus Christ is very important. The RU program, in a nutshell, is, do you love your Savior more than your sin? Sin causes us so many problems. But I'd say an even greater problem is our lack of love for our Savior. Today I want to talk about a very special man, the God-man. In verse 29 it says, "Come, see a man which told me all things ever I did. Is not this the Christ?" Please turn to Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews chapter 1 towards the back of your Bible. Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews chapter 1. And I'd like to say, first of all, come see a man that never lost his deity. Very quickly, let's look at these verses. Hebrews chapter 1, beginning with verse 5. "For unto which of the angels said he at any time, Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. And again, when he bringeth in the first begotten into the world, he saith, And let all the angels of God worship him. And of the angels he saith, Who maketh his angels spirits, and his ministers a flame of fire? But unto the Son he saith, Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. And thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thine hands." Quickly, let me just superficially describe these verses. In verse number 5, God is talking. He asks the question, are there any angels that he asked to be part of the Trinity? Particularly the Father-Son relationship. And the answer is no, he did not. In verse 6, then he says, the part of the Trinity that I'm going to will, meaning God the Father, in John chapter 1, verse 13, will be born on the earth, and you angels will worship him. The Bible never even hints the false doctrine of Jesus and Lucifer as angels or being brothers together. That's false doctrine. People with this kind of thinking need some type of padded room or straitjacket. That is not a new thing. The Bible says there's nothing new under the sun. The blasphemers in the New Testament, the Pharisees, they said the same thing of Jesus Christ. They said, He hath Beelzebub. Verse 7, God continues asking the angels, Who made you? The answer is Jesus. Verse 8, now God tells Jesus, is talking to Jesus, and he calls him God. So God the Father, in verse 8, calls God the Son, God. You need to mark that verse down whenever Jehovah's Witness try to pull the wool over your eyes. You have God the Father calling God the Son, God. And God said he's the eternal God of the future while talking with him as God in the present. So Jesus was not some created God, as false religions may say. Jesus always was, is, and always will be. That's why he is the great I am. Amen? In verse 9, here God said Jesus anointed above all the biblical priests. What's the cross reference to that? The cross reference to that is Isaiah 7, verses 14 through 16, the birth of Emmanuel, God with us. So when we talk about come see a man, we're not just talking about a baby in a manger, which we celebrate at Christmas time. We're talking about God in the flesh. Verse 10, God of eternal past. Eternal God of eternal past, present, and eternal future. Jesus Christ, come see a man that never lost his deity. This man was not Muhammad. Muhammad never had any deity. He never claimed to have any deity. In the Quran, he actually said that he was a sinner. This man is not Joseph Smith, who led the Mormons, who believes that you someday will become deity. Another lie. Alexander Campbell, he believes that when you're baptized, the water becomes deity and washes your sins away. Buddha, he did not have any deity. He couldn't even control his own weight. Mary Eddie Baker, the founder of Christian Science, that isn't Christian and isn't science and isn't a bishop of her church because she's not the husband of one wife. It's not the Pope, because the Pope is nothing more than a political figurehead by which the devil works to deceive millions of lives year after year after year with false Catholic doctrine. You say, Brother Yoder, do you hate all Catholics? Spanish people, do I hate Catholics? No, I don't. But their religion is false and wrong. No, the man never lost his deity, that never lost his deity was a little baby that was born to a pure virgin called Mary. This baby named Emmanuel, God with us, Jesus is the one that would save sinners from eternal hell. How is this possible? Because Jesus was 100% man and 100% God. Before Jesus was born in the manger, he was God. Before he was formed, Jesus in a human body with a beard and hair and skin and bones, he was God. Before, while he was laying in the manger with shepherds all around, in the other hand, he held the universe itself. When he went to school, he was God. When he worked for about 20 years as a carpenter, he was God. When he entered the ministry and was baptized by John the who? What was that? Yeah, John the Baptist, not John the Catholic, not John the Lutheran. This is still a Baptist church, amen? He was God. Jesus did not go down under the water a man and come up God. He went down 100% man and 100% God and came up 100% man and 100% God, amen? When he was laughed at and made fun of by the Pharisees, he was God. When he was tempted by Satan during that temptation and after the temptation, he was God the whole time, not just because he did not sin, but because he was God. He knew the sadness of friends dying. He knew the horribleness of those in illness, yet he was God just as he knows these things today. When he was on the earth in a body, the body of a human being, God hung between two thieves. And as he died for you and I, not for one second did he cease to be God. Come see a man that never lost his deity. Now he's in heaven, the God of all gods. Imagine a man who never owned a house, the one who has never yet been married, but is the wealthiest and most attractive of all. Please turn to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, and we'll read verse 6. Who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Come see a man that never lost his deity. But number two, come see a doctor that never lost a case. Please turn to Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12, verse 15, the Bible says, "But when Jesus knew it, he withdrew himself from thence, and great multitudes followed him, and he healed them all." Turn to Luke chapter 4, please. Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, let's take a look at verse 40. "Now when the sun was setting, all they that had any sick with divers diseases brought them unto him. And he laid his hands on every one of them and healed them." Turn to chapter 6. Chapter 6, verse 19. "And the whole multitude sought to touch him, for there went virtue out of him and healed them all." Hey, I want to tell you tonight, the world needs a doctor. Not just a doctor physically, but a spiritual doctor as well. Man's greatest need is not for the body, but for the healing of the soul. I'm tired of doctors practicing. Now, thank God that there's a few good ones out there. That one we had Sunday night, that Dr. Martin, he's a good doctor. People are living longer and longer since the time of the Old Testament. And I'm thankful that God has allowed some advancement in science so that we could have some medicine to help us get by. However, the mental condition and the spiritual condition of America alone is in a desperate need for a real physician. The dirty minds of men are beyond the help of a calm-down pill. I had a wise Sunday school teacher by the name of Mr. Baker back when I was 13 years old. And he said you could gauge the condition of the country by the women. He said the men have always been rotten, but when the women get dirty, we're through. You think about that. We're just about through. Today, young people have no respect for authority. Their hearts are full of rebellion, fighting, hate, lust, and jealousy. We're surrounded by spiritual ailments because of sex out of the bonds of marriage. Today, fornication is the normal, not the abnormal. AIDS is running wild. Homosexuality is totally out of control. We don't hear about those things anymore. Back in the 70s, it was a big deal. But we've just kind of shoved it under the rug, but it hasn't gotten any better. It's gotten worse. Now we have the cell phones and everything that go with them. When I was a kid, something like a cell phone was just like a Star Trek thing. Now people use them for some unbelievable things. We live in a nation where the American thoughts are not on Jesus Christ. We're messed up big time. I remember when I was in eighth grade, I had a teacher you know, she was one of those teachers that still had prayer in the classroom. And back then, you could get away with some things. They really didn't lower the hammer too much on that kind of stuff, even though you weren't supposed to do it. And she was my seventh grade English teacher. And she had been divorced 3 times. Well, my wife and I, we had just moved in from Colorado. After I got out of the Army in Colorado, we moved into the Canton area. And we moved in a basement apartment. And there was a guy across the way from us. There was a laundry room between our apartment and his apartment. And one day he came out and he said, "Dave, you're not going to believe this. I met the woman of my dreams. This woman, she's just unbelievable, and on top of that, she's a great Christian too." Well, a couple weeks passed, and I was out washing off my car or something. And he comes over and says, "Dave, I want you to meet my girlfriend. We're going to be getting married." You'll never guess who it was. My eighth grade English teacher, down the altar for the fourth time. "Hey, I want to tell you, we have a doctor that never lost a case. During the Christmas time, how many houses were filled with drunken fathers full of liquor and acting stupid because of beer? Society says it's okay, but this Bible says that it's not okay. It's not sickness, it's sin. Our society is sick because of sin, but I've got good news. Come see a doctor that never lost a case. The common cold, no cure. Pneumonia, no cure. Down's children, no cure. America is so sick they think the answer is just killing them. MS, no cure. Emphysema, no cure. AIDS, no cure. Blindness, no cure. Sexual diseases, no cure. Cancer, no cure. Autism, no cure. And no cure for sin by a man except one man, and that's the God-man, the man that never lost his deity, and the man that can heal all things. This man is a doctor that never lost a case. Jesus can cleanse you of all your sin. Don't pretend that the sin that you have is too strong for this doctor. He's never lost a case, and he's not going to. Turn to Joshua chapter 5, Old Testament. Joshua chapter 5. Let's go to the end of the chapter. Joshua chapter 5. The Bible says in verse 13, "And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lift up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, Art thou for us or for our adversaries? And he said, Nay, but as captain of the host of the Lord I am now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship and said unto him, What saith my Lord unto his servant? And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, Loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place whereon thou standest is holy. And Joshua did so." Number three, come see a captain that never lost a battle. We have our excuses about why we don't want to serve the Lord like we should. We have our excuses why we go to the men's breakfast and over half the crowd leaves to go home. We have our excuses why we just can't serve the Lord. But I want to tell you, the Lord don't care about your excuses. Why? Because he's a captain that has never lost a battle. We have got to have people going out and actively talking and presenting the gospel so that people have an opportunity to be saved. If this church is not reproducing, it will die. And yes, I understand that it's the Lord that builds the church. I understand that. But we have to do our part in fulfilling the Great Commission. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. If you line up all the unsaved people of the world in a single file line, and that line grows 20 miles a day, how are we going to win the world for Christ if we won't open our mouth for him? We have a job to do, and that job can be done. Why? Because we have a captain that never lost a battle. We do have the benefit of a church. We do have the benefit of a Bible. We do have the benefit of a pastor. You have people all around you that are praying for you constantly. There is no reason for you not to live the victorious Christian life. The Bible says a just man falleth seven times and rises up again. Yes, you're going to make mistakes. Yes, you're going to fall. But get down on your knees and pray and ask that captain of our faith to lead you on to victory. You say, Brother Yoder, I know what you're saying is right, but I'm just so tired, and I'm just so worn down. And you know what? You're absolutely right. The Bible says in Daniel chapter 7, verse 25, speaking of the devil, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High. You see, you can't get outside this body of flesh, no matter how hard you try. That's what Buddha tried to tell people they could do, that they could get outside of their body and view things from a different viewpoint, but you can't do that. You're in here. When you're hungry, you're hungry. When you're thirsty, you're thirsty. And you can pretend that you're not, but you are. And when you're tired, you're tired. But believe it or not, as Ripley used to say, you're in a battle for your life, and we have a captain to where victory is at hand. Come see a captain that never lost a battle. Who is this captain? This was the one that was lying in the manger. The greatest captain ever is Jesus Christ. He never lost a battle. The enemy is there. The enemy is unfair. The enemy is strong. The enemy hates you. The enemy hates the Word of God. But I know a captain who is greater, who is stronger, and of all of his enemies put together. Come see a captain that never lost a battle. Do you realize in the Bible, the book that you're supposed to be reading, book after book after book, is about great victories of a captain? How many of you have ever read the Old Testament? It's a book about battle. Number four, come see a shepherd that never lost a sheep. Jesus said in the garden, those thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them is lost. When you have salvation in Jesus Christ, it's a sure thing. The gift of eternal life is a sure thing. I remember when I was a little kid. I mean, I was really little. I was probably 6 or 7 years old. My dad, somehow, he got me this electric race car set. Man, I thought that was the greatest thing. But I didn't have that thing a year, and pieces started busting on it. The wheels got all burned off and started going bad. The track started breaking. And that thing isn't even around anymore. I want to tell you, as a little kid, that race car set was a wonderful gift. But it wore out and busted up. And I took good care of it, too. But your salvation is not that way. It doesn't get old and crusty and all of a sudden disappear. Let's look at John chapter 10. Please turn to John chapter 10. John chapter 10, beginning with verse 9. I am the door, by me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief cometh not but for to steal, and to kill, and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd, watch it now, giveth his life for the sheep. The Bible says that Jesus said right here, if anybody's going to die, it was going to be him. Why? Because he's the door, and they have to go through the door to get to you. And it says here that it would be easier for Jesus to lose his life and go to the devil in hell than it would be for you. But that's never going to happen. Jesus is not going to die and go to hell. And Jesus is heaven at the right hand of the Father. But Jesus said these things to help you to be sure That regardless of your body or your physical condition, you can know for sure, based on His word, that you have eternal life. You don't have temporary life or probationary life till you blow it. If that was the case, we'd all be going to hell. Amen? Let's look at verse 28. I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. Ben, why don't you come on up here? Or not Ben. Brian, come on up here. Scotty, come on up here. Dan, come on up here. I want you three guys to stand right here. Can I use you for just a minute? Come on up here.
I don't remember your name.
Adam's brother.
Adam. Okay, Adam. Adam, we'll say that Adam's a Christian. Adam, you a Christian? Amen. All right. For our illustration, we're gonna say right now that Scotty, you're gonna have to pretend, people. Okay. we're gonna say that Scotty is Jesus. All right. Can you pretend with me? Amen. We're gonna say that Scotty is Jesus. So put your hand like this. Okay. Scotty, put your hands all around him, over on top of him, like that. Okay. You got a good grip on him here. Okay. Jesus was the one that said that I have them and none of them are lost. So this is Jesus. God the Father, Jesus said in the next verse, He said, I and my Father are one. I'm in the Father and the Father in me. So this right here is going to be the Father. All right? So put your hands. No, not on him. Underneath there. Get them all the way around good and tight. Yeah, there we go. Okay? So now we got Adam in Christ and Christ in God. And the Bible says that the Holy Spirit seals us till tomorrow. No, until the day of redemption. All right, so Brian here, he's going to be the Holy Spirit. So get in all the cracks. Okay? Now, this is just an illustration here. But Adam, if you wanted to get out, could you?
Yeah.
It's just an illustration. Okay. But you see what I'm trying to prove. Okay? Thank you for your help. But this thing about, well, what if I want to get out? Or what if I don't want to be a Christian anymore? Or it's not what I thought it was. Too bad, you're going to heaven.
Amen.
The main reason why people don't know for sure whether they're saved after they've been saved is because He tells us in verse 27, My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. The reason that people think they're saved and lost and saved and lost and saved lost are for two main reasons. They don't believe that God is going to keep His word because they don't keep theirs, and they don't follow. They don't believe that God will keep His word because they don't keep theirs. And they don't follow. But I want to say, come see a shepherd that never lost a sheep. Let's turn to Hebrews again, chapter 5. We're almost finished. You've been very kind to me. Thank you. Hebrews chapter 5. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 9, the Bible says, And being made perfect, He became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. Now, that's not obeying by working your way to heaven. The Bible says in Romans chapter 9, by obeying the gospel, and that is belief in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. He says, if you believe that, you've asked him to be your personal Savior, you have eternal salvation. How many people is that given to? All that call upon him for salvation. Why? Because he's the author of it. He's the author of eternal salvation. There's only one type of salvation, and that's eternal salvation. If you don't have eternal salvation, you're not saved. How many sins are too many to not let you into heaven? One. If you've committed one sin, you're guilty before God. So unless you have a complete, perfect, sinless life, and you weren't born as a sinner, you're a goner. But I want to say tonight, come see a shepherd that never lost a sheep. Come see a man. Come see a man that never lost his deity. Come see a doctor that never lost a case. Come see a captain that never lost a battle. Come see a shepherd that never lost a sheep. And last, come see a fighter that never threw in the towel. Go to chapter 12, Hebrews chapter 12. Let's look at verse 2. Hebrews 12, 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Consider him, because he didn't quit. What will it take? Listen to me, teenagers. What will it take to get you to quit on Christ? Sir, what will it take you to quit on Christ? The loss of a job? A marriage gone bad? What will it take to make you quit? Well, when you get ready to consider Jesus Christ, who endured the struggle for you. But you know, Christmas, the manger, and all that stuff, it's over. But tonight I'm not preaching a Christmas message. I'm preaching a message for today. I want to ask you, have you seen the Savior today? Here it is right here. Did you spend time with God? If you have a man that never lost his deity, you have a doctor that never lost a case, a captain that never lost a battle, shepherd that never lost a sheep, and a fighter that never threw in the towel, what seems to be the trouble? The trouble is, you're not looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. Let's have every head bowed and every eye closed. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you said in 1 John chapter 5, and this is the record that God hath given to us, eternal life, and this life is in his Son. I thank you that we have the Word of God, and we know that we have the true God, Jesus Christ the righteous, because of your Word. And I'd ask now, Lord, that we'd get a new look at you, that we would draw closer to you than ever before. Lord, I'm not trying to hurt anybody. I want to help these people with all my heart. I pray that they would be honest. Some of them need to come see a man like they never have before. How many would say, Brother Yoder, I'm not really sure that I'm saved. I'm not sure that I have eternal life. but I'd like to have it. If that's you, would you raise your hand so I can pray for you? You say, I don't know if I have eternal life, but I'd like to. Please pray for me. If that's you, would you put your hand up so I can pray for you? All right. Last then, how many would be honest and say, Brother Yoder, there's something in this message that was for me. If that's you, would you put your hand up? Amen. Amen. Put your hands down. Heavenly Father, you saw the hands, but more than that, you know the hearts. You know what every one of these people need because you are God Almighty. So I'd ask that you'd help them now during this invitation time, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand as she plays.
Have thine own way.
Have you been trusting in the Lord? Oh, you talk a good talk, but when the pressure's on, do you trust Him? How's your service for the Lord? Have you been telling your friends about Jesus? Have you been making time these past couple weeks to go and tell somebody about a man who never lost his deity? About a captain who could help them with all their battles in life? Maybe you're just too busy. God knows. Would you be honest about it? Hey, how about you, teenager, that's been wasting your life, fiddling around, doing nothing? Give yourself to God. Use your life for Him. He said it's only your reasonable service.
Through one more stanza. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for your word. I thank you for what Brother Yoder has brought this evening, Lord. Recognition of who you are, the shepherd, the captain, the man who never lost his deity. Lord, what a great reminder it is that you are perfect in all points. In every point. And we're just so grateful to be able to serve a God who deserves our service. Lord, I thank you for the message this evening. I pray that you would send us home with a song in our heart and a word in our heart, Lord. And I pray that we would just continue to look to you, the author and finisher of our faith. In Jesus' precious name we do pray. Amen. Amen. That was great. Well, let's sing our closing hymn, 128, The Windows of Heaven, if you need it still. 128. The windows of heaven are open. The windows of heaven are open. The blessings are falling tonight. There's joy, joy, joy in my heart. Since Jesus made everything right, I gave him my old tattered garments. He gave me a robe of pure white. I'm feasting on manna from heaven, and that's why I'm happy. That's why you're happy. That's why we're happy tonight. Amen. You are dismissed. Choir, come on up.